question here.
Good morning, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Introduce yourself, Shrushti.
Madam, my name is Shrushti Jayant Deshmukh and I belong to Bhopal, Madhya Pradesh. I have done my graduation in Chemical Engineering from Lakshmi Narayan College of Technology, Bhopal itself. And I've done my schooling from Carmel Convent School. Some of my hobbies are yoga and meditation. And I look forward to join the civil services because provide me a platform to work for the social welfare at the grassroots level.
Coming from a chemical engineering background, why do you or how do you perceive that you will be able to do social welfare?
Chemical engineering is a subject that I chose for graduation because I had an interest in chemistry and sciences. Civil services was there in the back of my mind from earlier itself, and chemical engineering itself is a field that has varied applications, and whether it is disaster management or environmental engineering, manufacturing, there are a lot of issues with which chemical engineering is associated, and so I think my knowledge would definitely be helpful.
Hailing from Madhya Pradesh, is it not? So can you tell us some UNESCO heritage sites in your state?
Madhya Pradesh is very rich in whether it is natural or other heritage places. So some of the sites, for example, sir, the Sachi Stupa, which is a Buddhist stupa site. Then apart from it, Khajuraho temples are really famous. They belong to the medieval era. Then, apart from this, Pachmadi Biosphere, Manan Biosphere Reserve is also a very important site. That is the only hill station in Madhya Pradesh.
Why is Bhopal called a city of lakes?
Because apart from the ancient time, there are a lot of lakes here. The present condition is not that really good. But about 50 to 70 years ago, we had 11 to 12 lakes. Today, the condition is that two lakes are very properly maintained. One is the upper lake and the other is the lower lake. And in the old area, there are a lot of lakes even today, 5 to 6 lakes.
Do you see any role to make use of or better use of these lakes in case if they are polluted or anything else?
Yes. Lakes as part of the environment are really important. They not only somehow help regulate the temperature, provide a cooling effect, but at the same time for the biodiversity, lakes are really important. In that sense, lakes in Bhopal, as a chemical engineer, I see it that they are used for drinking water purposes. So city supply systems for water are sourced from the lake. So properly, if they are polluted, if they are polluted, then the entire health system of these city might collapse. So it is really important that both the primary, secondary, and tertiary water treatment systems are properly working, so that the pollution levels are controlled and the purity of the water is enhanced.
I think recently Niti Aayog was saying about the status of different states based upon health and other sustainable development goals. And Madhya
yes.
Pradesh is yet having lots of challenges on the health side, particularly on the MMR, female PT side and other things. How do you think you can address these challenges if you become your district collector?
I do unfortunately acknowledge, ma'am, that Madhya Pradesh is lagging behind in health parameters, as you rightly stated. Infant mortality rate is the highest in the country, which is 50 children per thousand. So as a district collector, given an opportunity, I think we need to first work on the very basics that the women should be of a mature age. As it happens, women are married early, they have very low levels of nutrition. 56 to 70% of women are anemic. So I think the first is that we make sure that women are getting nutritious diet, as the different programs are also going on, the ICDS and others. So all of these institutional deliveries also need to be made sure. After that, vaccination levels are something that I will focus on, because only 42% vaccination is prevalent as of now, which is very low. And apart from that, hygienic diet should be ensured in the first 1,000 days of a child, when the child is born, that golden days, so that the adequate level of nutrition can be maintained and the health levels could be improved.
Extending into the health issues, how do you view this legalizing of passive euthanasia in India?
Passive euthanasia, as it has been recently allowed by the Supreme Court in the Common Cause case, I see passive euthanasia as a good start, because there are a lot of people who are in the permanent vegetative state and are unable to live properly. They themselves have such intrusive medical equipments that they hurt their bodies as well. Even the pressure is on the family members. They are not able to either take care of them or improve their condition. So in such scenario, passive euthanasia should be allowed, and on a case-to-case basis, if the proper care is taken by the district administration and the medical board, I think it is a good move in that direction.
What's your take on the current issue which is going on in Shabrimala? Do you think the women in the menstruating age should be allowed to enter into the temple premises?
My personal take on this is, madam, whether it is male or female, the right to worship should be given to all. I especially see that the women of the age of 10 to 50 years who are mature and of menstruating age are not allowed. But I see it as a discriminatory fact. And I see that, I think that this is a relic of tradition that should be gone. The menstruation, a lot of time, the polluting element has been associated with it. But as we have developed in biological sciences and other fields, we must understand that it is a part of the women's body. And I don't think that it should be considered polluting. And that is why I believe that women should be given entry to Sabarimala in line with the Supreme Court judgment.
Current issues which are going on there. There's a hartal. There were like 3 to 4 people who were killed yesterday, and the entire community is, in a mode of a backlash. And even though the authorities are in a position to implement the orders of the court, the local community doesn't perceive it the same way. On one end, if you see the directive of the court have somehow intervened into the customary practices, and don't you think that these things should also be taken into consideration? There are many other temples in the country wherein women are allowed to worship, and there are also temples wherein men aren't allowed to visit. So why can't one maintain the sanctity of that particular temple and let it go just like that?
Madam, different issues. I'll just try to address it. Beginning with the first point, that there are many temples where men are not allowed. Now, in that case, men as a class are not allowed. But in the case of Sabarimala, it is not that women per se are not allowed. It is that women of a particular age are not allowed. In that sense, that is discriminatory. The second thing, coming to the traditions and the customary laws, definitely traditions and norms come in the historical traditions once they are followed for a lot of years. But India has had this experience, we are a transitional society, that we have been advancing ahead, and a lot of other issues, say triple talaq or entry into other mosques, all of these are coming up as an issues and we are taking it as a society. I think even in this issue, we should respect the fact that the society is moving forward, and I understand that the local traditions to some extent might be against it. I know that it will take time for the local people, even the women and the men, to understand that the women should be given rights. But I believe that the government should be pursuing it. I'll try to compare this issue with the entry of Dalits in the temples. Even at that time, there was a lot of opposition to it. The very fact that the Dalit would walk in front of the temple was considered defiling. And we have come far ahead as a society. So I think that even in this issue, there will be certain developments, certain opposition. But I think one should persevere on this front and allow the same. And another thing, madam, as you asked about the customary traditions, one of the arguments of the Sabarimala side issue is that Lord Ayyappa is a deity. Who has very special requirements or any such thing of his own. And it is said that he is celibate. So this thing is that women should not be allowed. My personal take is that the worship of a woman in any form would not, I would defile the celibacy of a god. And we all, I think, the women do worship Lord Ayyappa at home. So I think they should be allowed in the temple as well.
Okay. What is your opinion on the current controversy which is going on in Assam, especially with respect to the citizens register?
The current issue in Assam with regard to the National Register of Citizens, that is made in accordance with the Assam Accord of 1985. A lot of people have been left out. The numbers estimate that about 3 million people have not got their names in the register, and they are also unable to prove their citizenship. I believe that this issue has multiple perspectives. The first is the security point. There have been reports that illegal migrants have been coming from neighboring countries, unfortunately like Bangladesh, etc. And there have been certain activities which can be anti-national. So there's one perspective that we need to make sure that we understand, and the integrity and security of the country should be first put. The second issue, which is a very humanitarian issue, is that many people came here and in the olden times there were no birth certificates, even the lands they could not get registered. So they have been living here for so long, but they are unable to prove it. And now their cases are pending in front of the foreign tribunals. I think there should be additional time given to these people so that they can prove their claim for citizenship. And again, I would also add that the further developments do not really show that there could be any sending back of these people to Bangladesh if at all they are found that they are from there. So we need to step up cooperation with Bangladesh and other neighboring countries as well to come out with a comprehensive solution.
Shrushti, tell us some experience that you've had when you were part of this anti-ragging wing.
The anti-ragging wing in my college was making sure that all of the youngsters, the first year students who join the college, and after that anybody and whoever is junior to us, was taken care of. The fact that anybody should not harass the person or put him or her in an uncomfortable situation, something that could be against her or his personal understanding of decency. So some of my experiences was entrusted with the bus so that anybody who was boarding the bus and the entire journey, I was making sure that nobody is misbehaving, and I tried to ensure that a friendly atmosphere is created and a proper friendly interaction could be conducted, because that is also important. We also got to learn a lot of things from our seniors, and I tried to communicate that to my juniors as well.
Shrushti, can you bring out some differences between gender development index and gender inequality index?
Gender development index and gender inequality index. In my perspective, gender development index, I think, is the measure of how well the different development indices, like that of education, health, employment, all of these are accounted in for the women and for the males as well. But especially, I think the focus will be on women, because they are the ones who lag behind in a lot of issues. And the gender inequality index would be a specific comparison with the males to let us understand the deficit where women are very much lagging behind, and there are inequalities. For example, the women are paid less in employment sectors wherever they go, whether it is formal or informal. That will be a prominent measure in the gender inequality index.
Lots of news about GST and its collection and its impact on Indian economy. You have got something to say about it?
Madam, the GST collections, per se, I was just reading a report recently in a newspaper. They said that 90,000 crore was the collection in a month, but about something around it. But we have not been able to reach the ideal figure of 1 lakh crore. So that is a cause of concern, that is one. Given the fact that in the 31st meeting, the GST Council has taken out a lot of commodities from the 28% slab. So I think going forward, but yes, there's one more thing, that the income tax returns, the filing has increased, and the direct tax to GDP ratio has also increased to 5.98%, which is like the highest. So I think that we need to give GST some time. The goods and service taxes is integrating the economy together with the other factors. I think the collection should come up in the years to come, but probably the recent in the recent months there could be certain glitches in it. And another thing, ma'am, if you allow me to add, there's some issue with regard to the compensation given to the exporters. Probably the they are not able to get their, I'm just forgetting the term that is used, that levy, they are unable to get it. So that is a concern for the exporters, which should be addressed very soon. And technological issues should be stepped up. The platform should be such that it should be able to handle the massive transactions in a big country like India. Thank you.
The other major economic reform which the country underwent was demonetization.
Yes.
It was done for certain objectives. You think we have achieved the objectives with which we started?
The objectives, madam, if I were to state in a very brief, the attacking the black money, making sure that it is not in circulation, trying to curb the menace of counterfeit currency, and also corruption in that front. As far as the results are concerned, the RBI reports say that about 99% of the notes came back. So that is a thing that we would say that not a very positive result. Otherwise, the counterfeit currency somehow has come down. But I will say that a lot of progress has been made with regard to the compliance of a lot of people. The compliance of the direct taxes has gone down. Has gone up with the income tax filing. And another thing is that in this demonetization, a lot of data was generated for the tax department. So utilizing that data, the accounts, the big data I may call, further investigations could be conducted and there could be fruitful results on the same.
Shrushti, who's your favorite thinker in sociology?
Sociology, my favorite thinker. My favorite thinker would be Max Weber, ma'am.
Why do you like him?
As I read about other theories, I felt that they were a bit extremist, to say in a crude term. They were trying to, I would take a mild routine. He took a very scientific approach towards studying sociology. Karl Marx gave it a political flavor and divided things into haves and have-nots. In that perspective, Max Weber has used an interpretativist approach wherein he understands that human beings have emotions and there could be certain things that a human could perceive, and in his perspective, there could be certain changes. So that interpretativist understanding of Max Weber was something that I really like.
Can you tell me something about the concept of synergy of Emile Durkheim?
Concept of synergy. I'm sorry, ma'am, I'm not aware of it.
Recently, there was a committee constituted for improving MSMEs' performance, micro, small, medium enterprises. 2 days back, are we aware of any terms of reference about it?
Ma'am, with regard to the committee, I think the terms of reference.
No.
I'll try. Okay, ma'am, should I try with the terms of reference? I'm not really sure about it. Ma'am, should I go ahead?
No, terms of reference is what I asked you about the committee which was constituted for improving the performance of MSME. It was constituted.
No, ma'am, not really. I'm sorry, ma'am.
All right, Shrushti, thank you.
Thank you so much. It was a pleasure. Thank you.
Yeah, just hold on, huh?
Uh-huh.
Shrushti.
Yes, ma'am.
First, regarding the high points of the interview, first of all, your personality is very pleasing and you have a wonderful voice and intonation, and your articulation is also wonderful. So overall, until you go and do some kind of mistake, the probability of getting less marks is very, very less. The low points in whatever you have told today in the interview is, you have a tendency to go roundabout in answers. You're still in the mains mode, wherein you're targeting answers like that, wherein you have a little more time to answer. Here, the attention span is a little less. So you'll have to focus on giving specific answers. And that's one. And another part of it is, for a certain set of questions that we've asked, we thought that you gave little generic answers. You should improve on the specificity of tackling the keywords in the given question when you're trying to put forth your answer. That's one another part which we'd want to say. Maybe we would go question by question so that, like, you'd also get an idea on where all you could improve. Okay. First of all, I think in your introduction to yourself, you did very well. You spoke very well about what we wanted to know about you. That part of it, there's nothing to change. The next part, ma'am asked you a question on chemical engineering and its utility in civil services. For this question, the points that you wanted to tell was actually good, but then you didn't make it a little specific. For example, when they ask you how will you utilize this in civil services, you'll have to talk about the various applications of civil engineering which could be of help. Like, ma'am was giving a clue a little later on wherein she was talking to you on lakes and pollution and how as a chemical engineer you would work on targeting that pollution, right? So maybe you could go take a clue from what she had asked as a question. That itself could be put in as something which you can tell in your why do you to enter civil services or what exactly you can do there. So there, I think you could have gone a little more specific. Okay?
The other question, which was about the health, right? MMR and PIN and PPC. I think you need to pick up from the question the keywords. You started answering, of course, IMR is very high. So if you could also say a word about how high is the MMR in your state and how the female feticide issue is really an issue in the state, with some numbers or some perspective. And then you as a district administrator said what are all the things which you can do. That was fine. But to control female feticide, I think you need to bring in lots of awareness in the society, right? So it's not a thing like by which you can improve the nutrition or anything else as an intervention, but it's basically a behavioral thing. So from your sociology perspective also, you could add some more things how you can address female feticide, right? So
I missed that. Make sure that really understand each and every case.
There's something which we also want to tell you. One is we have a very effective schemes for controlling feticide, but there is also a problem of infanticide in certain places, right? So in case you get questions like that, then there are some successful models, like what the state of Tamil Nadu has. It's called the cradle baby scheme, wherein you know, the children who do not have adequate protection or the mothers who do not have adequate protection, the state takes care of those children. There is some kind of a scheme like that. So in that particular question which madam had asked you, your control strategies were very good, but actually the question on connecting those two aspects, I think that part of it you had a little, you missed out a little bit on that. Okay.
Yes.
Want to say something?
Yeah, and see ma, this UNESCO heritage site, there are actually four sites na. Panchmarhi doesn't come under that. So you should be
learning
about the Imbedka case and all that. So if you know only two, you mention only the two that you know. That's okay. It's okay if you don't tell answers to every question.
And city of lakes part, pollution part, all that was fine. And the path of euthanasia, your opinion was actually very good. But then I think you could also cite a few cases. Like last year, we've had a couple of cases. Maybe you could mention that. Either you go with the cases or you go with, you know, some technical terms which we use in our subject. That could also be another way in which you can substantiate the view on that particular answer. Just a suggestion from our side. Opinion was good. Shabrimala, you were like very good, very strong, and very beautiful arguments. So you can maintain whatever you are telling in that. It's very nice. Experience of anti-ragging squad, that was also very good. Yeah, the gender development and gender inequality index, I think ma'am will tell you on that.
I think gender development is exactly HDI, human development index, which is studied across men and women. So you need to mention, you said about education health. The third one is standard of living. So standard of living. So that needs to be known. And gender inequality is basically studying health, education and empowerment. Of all the three things which are taken into consideration, health is the most important thing. That's why we study about this MMR, adolescent fertility rate, those things. So health is a major problem which is across the world causes the gender inequality. So they are international indicators both published by the UNDP. We need to be
study further.
Just be precise on it. About the GST collection, I think there are lots of implementation issues which are going right now. I think you came to that part towards the end. Then you were telling about the direct taxes collection have gone up. I think when we are asking you about the domain of indirect taxes, pick up an example of like two things and then say it. Or why is this exactly not happening? You have to reason it. They can see these are the reasons, and therefore we need to improve upon it. If it is an implementation issue, we can say like government has to simplify the things. If it is an economic issue, like say the economy is actually slowing down, which is why the collections are not becoming better. And the point what you said about the reduction of the rate, I think the current affairs thing got into your mind and you reflected upon it. That has to happen only in the future. Just now we have done it. So you can't be like counting it upon for the retrospective thing. So maybe you should say it like this, now that they have brought in, brought down the rates of certain things, the collections may still further go down, and therefore implementation issues or other things have to be taken care of in a proper way so that the collections not go down in the future. So you need to like pull in all the data in a way how you can answer to the question.
Yeah.
Demonetization objectives, you said it very precisely and correctly. It was like very comprehensive. And if you say 3 points, pick up each point and say whether you have achieved it or not. Instead of rather getting into a generalized way after to that, you said like black money circulation has come. You pick up the first point and then say that yes, it has come down to a certain extent. The government was successful in wiping away because all the notes were like the major currencies were taken back and it was re-monitored, a different thing. However, corruption is still happening. So corruption, we can't say that it has been completely taken away from the counterfeit currency, of course, we have addressed major things, but still there is infusion of currencies which are coming from the border countries, other countries. Are even have the example of Bangladesh one time like pumping in lots of 2,000 currencies inside the country. So we are in the track of it, but whether we have really achieved, we have to wait and see. Some like be specific to the 3 points, whatever you said. Right?
Okay.
The last thing. The last question, which was about MSME, please go back and read about Sinha's committee. They have a tendency of asking the current affairs within the 2-3 days, right? Sinha, Sinha. A recent committee has been constituted. And in economics, I think it's one like major area which they keep talking about micro, small and medium enterprises. There are lots of issues, right? So one tax issue we addressed. The other, this economic issue, if we could also like be on track with the current affairs, we'll be able to do it.
Yes, ma'am.
And, regarding this mild Durkin and synergy, this is a question which is more to do with the collective conscience. That's what they are referring as. Wherein energy is the synthesis of the energy of the different people, wherein he tells that the whole is greater than the parts. And when he talks about society sui generis, that's what he's actually referring to. So that is the concept that is meant.
Thank you, ma'am.
So overall, Shrushti, for the answers, you ensure to bring in a little more specificity to your answers and make answers like what you did for Shabarimala, your opinion questions on that, and the demonetization answer that you gave. If you are able to present answers like this, at least like for majority of the questions which they are asking in the interview, the scores will really spiral up like anything, because you did these two questions really well. They like hit gold there. Very good. You'll have to maintain the consistency all throughout. And if you do that, I think it should be pretty fine.
Okay. Ma'am, there are two questions. Can I ask you?
Yeah, yeah.
Ma'am, the first one is that when a question is asked, I am unable to like just respond. That's why I take some time to build on the issue, like the main mode. So could I just take some few seconds before I start uttering anything? Can that be done?
It is in fact expected of you to take a couple of seconds before you come up with an answer. Nobody expects you to just speak like a bullet out of a gun. It's not expected, because as bureaucrats, there are a lot of things which you have to think and then do. So taking a few seconds and then answering, up to 5 to 6 seconds if you are taking to answer, it is nothing wrong. Beyond 10 seconds, if you think you need time, then you request permission of the board. Say that, can I take a few seconds to think and then do. But up to 10 seconds, it's pretty much accepted, because sometimes the questions are very lengthy, and to comprehend the question itself, it might take you time. Right? And it would also be the case, like you have boards of constituting of people from different parts of India, and the way they speak English might not be something which you could comprehend very easily. So sometimes it could also be the case. All right. And in case you get something like a case study kind of a question, then please use the paper and pen in front of you and jot down the key points. If you know that they are going a little lengthy and you are definitely not going to remember everything which they have mentioned. Normally what happens is, they'll present it and would have missed out something, and then we'll ask, sir, can you please repeat the question? And even after we repeat, we might not be in a position to answer, because we've missed out on a lot of things. So if you think that the question is going lengthy, you simply take that paper, the paper is for you only, take it and jot down the points and then start answering the question. Do you have anything else to ask?
In any case, should I give a brief intro and take some cues from the question itself? Should I at least about one or two sentences taking from the question and then getting to the point? Is that okay, or should I just hit the thing, like just whatever is asked, only that? Can I take some one or two sentences to build up on the issue?
Please go straight okay. To the question. Because interviews, they would consider this to be a repetition of what they've mentioned. So if you think that you will need to repeat it, you repeat it within yourself, do not vocalize it. And then maybe once you're ready with the answer, you come out and you mention. But do not repeat the question, or do not do it in the mains mode.
Yes, ma'am. And the very last question, ma'am. In the MSME question that you asked, for example, I was not aware of the committee, but I was aware of the issues of MSME. So should I have attempted the question, or should I have said no?
They actually asked to study about the issues only, right from the finance, right from the technology available, right from the failing of them, rehabilitation. They were the things, but if you are not specifically knowing, and then in all the cases, we may not be able to say that the terms of reference and the issues will be exactly coined in that particular. It's better if you read it and answer it with confidence. Otherwise, it's okay if you say that you do not know about it. Nothing wrong with it.
See, there are two ways, as ma'am was mentioning. One of it is like, I know something about it, And I do not know whether what I know is what exactly that the terms of reference are. So in that case, you are actually making a very calculated guess. So there are two ways to handle it. One is you could mention to the board, sir, I am not aware of this particular thing, but I am aware of a few problems which are reeling the MSME sector. So can I take a guess at it, sir? Or can I? That's one way. You can do it. On the other hand, if you have like no clue whatsoever of what is it or what they are telling, then you say there's nothing wrong. We've had students out of 20 questions, they have answered only 5 questions which are opinion questions, and still they've made 190 plus. So even if you don't answer a few questions, it's pretty fine. What you answer, you should hit gold in that.
Yes.
Should be like even after you leave, they remember you for something that you told or in the way that you have told something. That's it.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you, Shrushti.
Thank you. Thank both of you, ma'am. Thank you so much.